What's up, gamers? Welcome back to another Let's Play with me, Kyle the Survivor X3X, bringing you brand new survival game content every Tuesday, Thursday, and Sunday. And get excited, because this week we're back with another episode of Minecraft Hardcore Mode. Roll that intro. For almost 10 years now, survival games have been ubiquitous with a stale lack of creativity in game design. The Steam page for survival is a graveyard of half-baked ideas and failed ambitions. Sure, there's some that stick around, but for every The Forest, there's a Forlorn? And for every Ark Survival Evolved, there's an Ark Survival Evolved. If you've played one of these games, you've played them all. They all have a big open world to explore, usually procedurally generated. They all have various health bars and stamina bars and food bars that you have to maintain. They all have crafting mechanics for food and tools and shelter, and they all have some form of monster that you're eventually going to have to fight. Of course, there are differences between all of these games. That's why some of them succeed and some of them fail. A good hook is essential to survival in any game genre, but especially the survival genre. But the core of all these games is the same. They're each trying to evoke the same emotions, scratch the same itch. This is a video about Citizen Sleeper, a small indie game released last year to massive critical appraise, and we are going to get to it eventually, I promise. But first, we need to talk about survival games and how they work. To be completely honest with you, I've never much gotten into survival games. I usually try them and get bored pretty quickly. That has one major exception. A very major exception. A very, very major exception. So if you haven't heard of Minecraft before, yes you have, you're a liar. Minecraft is one of the most popular games in the world and has been for the last decade. It is the game that is most credited with starting the survival crafting genre and remains the most successful of all of them. Why? Well, because surviving in a world that doesn't want you to is inherently satisfying to most people. When you load up a game of Minecraft, you have nothing. No food, no shelter, no weapons, and a short amount of time until night descends and the monsters come out. The key to survival is ingenuity. Everything around you has a use, you just need to figure out what it is. Be it using the stone for tools, hunting the cows to make armor, hunting the zombies for delicious rotting flesh to eat. That's phase one, hunting and gathering. Once you've got the basics of survival down, you can start phase two, optimizing. Move from a hunter-gatherer to a farmer, growing crops to feed to your cows, and then going ham on the beef when the pen gets a little bit too crowded. This is also, if you're anything like me, when you take about 10 to 15 hours to build a ridiculously elaborate house. Once you've got the bottom half of Maslow's triangle covered, you can move into phase three, and this is the phase that Minecraft really excels in. You do whatever you want. Want to build a village and start a trade empire? Go ahead. Want to automate all of your resource gathering with technology? Sure can. Want to travel to other dimensions and fight dragons? Right this way, sir. What distinguishes survival games from a lot of other genres is that there isn't really an ending in mind for most of these games. And even if they do have some kind of narrative ending, it usually spits you into the world again after the credits, including Minecraft. Alright, we've got our wheat farm going nicely, Bessie and her friends are growing. I think what we do now is obvious. It's time to kidnap some villagers to live with us. Let's go! Phase 3 is when most players will start to drift away from the game, when they've done everything that they want to do, or everything that they feel that there is to do. That's why the majority of Minecraft's updates over the years are focused on Phase 3 content, giving you more and more stuff to do after you've accomplished the basics. Phases 1 and 2 are the core of all survival games, and when all of them have the most in common. They all appeal to a sort of industrious mastery over nature mentality, where you put everything to use, turn the dangerous untamed land safe, and better yet, productive. You don't just start up a survival game to survive, you come to conquer. Come on dude, just get in the boat. You're embarrassing me here, there's people watching, I don't have all day dude, seriously. It's an inherently fantasy proposition. If you dumped me in the middle of a forest, it would be a question of how I die, not if. I don't have the power to punch down a tree, nor the skills to build tools out of sticks, nor the heart to kill an animal for food. I can't even sleep if I'm not in a bed. But regardless of that, there's something appealing about the idea that you could, that surrounded by dangers, you could thrive, survive, and make a home for yourself. Just like how I can't slay a dragon or fight aliens with a machine gun, escapism is the driving emotion of these games, offering an experience that I could otherwise never actually have. I don't really want to be dumped in a forest with nothing but my wits to survive. That sounds awful. But in a video game, I'm free to indulge that fantasy. Welcome back everyone to another Let's Play with me, Kyle the Survivor X3X, and today we're going to be playing a new game. It was recommended to me by a friend of mine. It's called Citizen Sleeper. I know nothing about this game, but I hope it's a survival game because that's kind of my whole deal. Alright, let's jump into it. Citizen Sleeper is not a survival game. That's not how it's labelled on Steam anyway. It's a narrative-focused RPG with tabletop-inspired mechanics. You play as a sleeper, a robotic copy of a person who offered their brainwaves to a corporation in exchange for cash, with you as the result. A perfect worker who isn't technically illegal because you're not a full artificial intelligence. A perfect slave. After years of hard work, you and your peers mounted an escape attempt. It worked, sort of, but as you drifted through space, all of your fellow slaves died in the cold. Except for you. You washed up in the scrapyard of a city-sized space station, Erlin's Eye, the Eye for short, and now it's time to begin a new life. Gameplay-wise, Citizen Sleeper looks more complicated than it actually is. The game has a daily cycle, and each day you're given a random selection of dice from 1 to 6, and they can be used in a variety of different actions. A 6 is an automatic success, and a 1 is a 50-50 chance of failure or neutral, all of which you control via a bird's eye view of the station, except when conversing with NPCs, in which case a static image of them will appear next to their conversation. It really doesn't look like a survival game, does it? Except, remember all those core features that a survival game has? Well, let's take a look, shall we? Health and stamina bars that need to be maintained? Check. Crafting mechanics? Check. A big open world? Depends on your definition, but I'll allow it. Monsters you're going to have to fight? Definitely check. It's not a survival game in the way that we typically understand it, but it is for sure a game about survival. So like, is this the whole game? I feel like I'm not really doing anything here. I'm just working at a scrapyard for some old dude. Not exactly thrilling stuff so far. Love the art though. When you emerge from that storage crate you've been in for weeks, possibly months, you're cold, you're low on energy, and you've got nothing but the clothes on your back. Your only goal is survival. But there aren't any trees to punch, there are no cows to hunt. It's a space station, a city full of people. So you survive the city way. You find a job. How well you do in your job is affected by the dice, and how much you get paid, or even if you get paid at all, is affected by how well you do the job. Most jobs will also require energy, which as a sort of human robot you get from food that you of course have to buy. If you don't have energy, then you'll begin to starve, which will increase the rate of decline of your condition bar, and as your condition gets lower, you'll roll less dice each day. Losing health doesn't just make you weaker, it makes you less able to do things to prevent your death. And if that doesn't ring true, I don't know what does. I can't wake up in the forest and hammer a rock into a pickaxe with my bare hands. That's not a realistic experience. But waking up with a hand of ones and twos when I really need a six, that's an experience much truer to life. There is one other complicating factor that you need to consider. You're dying. By design, your synthetic body was built with a deliberate flaw that requires constant injections of a special stabilizing chemical to maintain. And that company is the only supplier. Your condition bar won't just go down when you're starving, it's always going down, and the only way to bring it back up is an injection of an extremely rare and expensive drug. Wait, the drug thingy costs like $100? That's like literally double the amount of money I have right now, dude. That's fucked, man. Imagine charging that much for medicine you literally need to live. Getting the money together to buy the drug that you need to live isn't easy, especially when you also need that money to eat. Most of the work you can do will only cover one meal per shift, so you'll need to be pulling overtime to get the cash together, and it's extremely unlikely that you'll have more than two in your inventory at once before the end game. To get back to our phases, the vast majority of Citizen Sleeper takes place in Phase 1, the hunter-gatherer phase. You won't reach Phase 2 until near the end of the game, and Phase 3? Well, there's never really a phase 3. You'll never reach a point where your stockpile is so high that you no longer need to worry about it. So I know what you're thinking. Wow, that sounds really boring and sad. Hold that thought for a minute. There's a reason Citizen Sleeper isn't sold as a survival game. It's technically an RPG, and so most of your time in the game is spent talking to NPCs. But Citizen Sleeper is not a typical RPG. You don't play a hero, you don't have a special destiny, you don't even have a goal. You're just a survivor. No more, no less. Citizen Sleeper is not a story with big moments. It's a story about the little moments, the small moments of kindness and cruelty to be found in the relentless grind of modern urban survival. You don't have quests like a typical RPG with places you have to be, things you have to do. You have drives, things you want to do, reasons to keep on surviving. Some drives are simple, explore parts of the station, have a deep chat with the street food vendor, help out the friendly bartender start her brewery. Some are more complicated, helping a maintenance worker uncover a conspiracy, saving an AI trapped in a vending machine. You don't have to do any of these things. You have to work because you have to eat and you have to buy your medicine, and then you can use whatever days you have left to make that survival meaningful. Alright, we did something. What's up, dude? Lem? That's a weird name. Oh, does he have a baby with him as well? Is he, like, taking her to work in this place? Seems kind of irresponsible, dude. Most tasks in the game, aside from the repeatable jobs, are based on clocks that fill in with each action role. That means that to progress any of these drives is going to take several days at minimum. The system means you can go several days without ever talking to anyone, just chipping away at the clocks without any positive reinforcement. That lack of feedback is important though. You aren't doing it for a reward. You're doing it because you want to, because it's a kind thing to do. Oh, he needs a babysitter? Sure, I can do that. No problem. No problemo, friendo. Every character has their own story to unfurl. Some are complicated. Some, like Lem and Mina, are simple. There's a colony ship, heading off to a new world, a dream of a better future that Lem wants him and his daughter to be a part of. You and him join the crew that build the ship, and the company has promised that one lucky worker will get to join the expedition. Neither of you win, obviously. You were never even in the running, but you can get the tickets through other means. A shady information broker named Caster can get them for you, if you allow him to use your synthetic body as a tracking device so he can see the ship's progress. The game has 8 endings, each of them tied to different characters' stories. 4 of them involve the situation with Lem and Mina, except only half of the endings actually end the game. The credits roll, yes, but you just exit back into the game. That's because these are the endings where you choose to stay on the station, the endings where you choose to keep on surviving. Wait a second, this literally just occurred to me. Won't I, like, die if I go on this ship? I need the drug thingy, right? I don't want to traumatize Mina by slowly dying in front of her. Maybe I don't go? Oh! The game's over, the credits are rolling. That was fast. I feel like I didn't really finish the game. And we're back. Okay, tell you what, guys. Let's call this episode here and we'll see if we can reach another ending next time. Why do I feel sad? The colony ship represents a dream, and if you choose to get on board with Lem and Mina, then you dream about the outcome of the journey. Lem dies before the ship ever makes it to port, your robotic body fails long before that, but an older Mina still cares for you, keeps you on minimal power, hoping to one day show you that new world that you all dreamed of. And your final moments are seeing her tears as you go offline for good. It's a bit of a gut punch to include this flash forward, sure, but that's kind of the point, isn't it? The colony ship may seem like an escape from the rat race, a way to secure a better future, but based on your circumstances, it can't be. At least not for you. Maybe it can be for Mina, and if that's all you care about, then maybe this ending is satisfying for you. But for me, it felt like a hollow victory. My first playthrough of the game, I hyper-focused on Lem and Mina's story. I wanted a better future for them, and I did everything in my power to make that happen. I didn't ever move out of the storage container. I didn't follow any of the other plot lines to completion. I didn't think I had to, because I was getting out. After this ending, though, I had to go back in. I felt like I had missed something, like I had played the game wrong. I died in the game about survival. If you keep playing on, if you let Lemonmina go on without you, then you can eventually reach Phase 2. Outside of the city area of the station is a massive expansive biodome called the Greenway. And within the Greenway is a different sort of community called the Haifa Commune. They're a small group of folks who disagreed with the current management of the station and came here to live life in their own way. They won't pay you for the work you do. Instead, as long as you've put in the work to help maintain the community, they'll feed you and give you a place to sleep. Better than that, you begin working with the commune's botanist who's been studying the unexplained growth and survival of the Greenway, and the two of you discover that it's being tended to by an old AI gardening routine gone to mass proportions. But the AI is benevolent. It wants all nature, including humans, and even including you, to flourish. After scanning your synthetic body and seeing the issue, it creates a new species of mushroom that can be used to create the stabilizer that your body needs. You can collect the mushroom seeds, grow them yourself, and take them back to the botany lab to make the stabilizer. For free. The botanist only asks that you have a nice chat with her while you're there. Both in a survival game way, and by the logic of the story, you've won. You've escaped the corporation's grasp and the system that they work in. You've regressed, in a way, back to the survival methods of Minecraft, farming for your food and living off the land, but to do so here and now, after being created for a life of tedious, hard labour for a corporation. To live truly for yourself, off of your own work, that is true freedom. Yes, in some sense you're stuck on the station, you need the medicine that it produces, but the dynamic is completely different. The gardener doesn't ask for anything in return. It wants to help you, and it does. It even offers you the chance to leave your body and join it in the cloud, another possible ending for the game. It did something nice for you, and in return, you can do something nice for it. Help tend to its garden. Citizen Sleeper, with its visuals, its hyper-capitalist setting, and its human-synthetic robot protagonist, is obviously a part of the cyberpunk genre, and like most cyberpunk stories, it's using its futuristic setting as a framework to talk about modern-day issues. The game obviously has a healthy dose of cynicism if the corporate robotic clone slaves weren't enough to give that away. But cynicism isn't actually the dominant emotion of the game. Kindness is. Survival in a 7-day gig work economy where every penny earned goes right back into the things that let you survive to keep working that job. It's a system designed to crush your soul, and it's a future that seems more and more likely with each passing day. But we're a resilient bunch, and no matter what circumstances you put us through, we'll find a way to survive and to thrive. As work becomes more and more of our day-to-day lives, moments of love and of kindness will become fewer and further between. But they'll never go away. And they will always be worth surviving for. Sorry if I seem a little less chatty today, guys. I had a rough day at work today. My boss was... Well, I probably shouldn't talk about it, but I just wanted to say how much I love you guys and the support you've given me these past few months. Subscriber growth has been incredible. Already 200! Making these videos for you guys is the best part of my day. Anyway, let's get into it. Today we're playing more Citizen Sleeper because they just added a new DLC episode and I want to see what's up.